Lord, we're grateful that we might pray for one another, especially for Brittany and others that are going through so much, Allison Haygood and others on our hearts. But also we're grateful that you're here with us as you are with Brittany as well as with Allison and the others we're praying for. And know that presence today helps our heart, encourages us, and feeds our soul. And we might rejoice and be glad in this moment to worship you in song and prayer. In Christ's name, amen. Good to see you all here today, your pretty faces. I got something here. You know what this is? Lemonade. Somebody can read, got good eyes. Gracious. Yeah, it's Crystal Light lemonade. Now, do I just tear it open and put it in my mouth? No, I wouldn't advise that. Okay. What do I do with it? You put this in water. It calls for 2 quarts of water. So it's nice to have this to make water taste a lot better, doesn't it? It's plain old water, but you put this in, it becomes Crystal Light lemonade. It doesn't have any sugar in it. That's a good thing in some ways. But that's kind of like what Jesus does for our life. When he comes into our heart, things taste a lot different. People seem a lot different. There's a lot of more goodness to see and to experience because Jesus came into our lives. And that's what we need to remember, that when Jesus came into the life of the people in the Bible, their lives were changed. And they began to be called salt and light. They began to be used by God in special ways. And that's what we hope when God comes in our lives, and what we feel and what we experience, is that our lives become a lot different, a lot better. Not only that we go to heaven, but we live in this world a lot different kind of person. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for what you do as you inhabit our lives, as we become different creatures. We become newborn, and we become new creatures in Christ. And we're grateful for these young lives, that they will experience life in Christ and experience life in a great way here at Stephen Green, but also when they go out in different places, when they grow up into Christ and in age to do things in the world. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Pastor. Let us pray. Father, we ask that you accept these offerings in a special way, in a way that our heart gives to you what you've led us to, what we feel gratefully towards you and your good gifts to us. Out of the great goodness of your giving and fulfilling our lives, an abundant life, and fulfilling our heart's desire to serve you. Thank you, Lord, for this which we return to you and know that you are Lord in our lives. For it's in Christ's name we pray and give. Amen. If you would like to follow along with John this morning, we'll be looking at a wonderful verse of scripture and a reminder that there's our life, in God's hands, and he's going to take care of us when we hunger for him. This event is the third appearing of Jesus to his disciples as a group. And I think it's important to our discipleship to hear this as we have talked about the other two appearings from the pulpit. John 21, the first 14 verses. Afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Galilee. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, also known as Didymus, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, James and John, and two other disciples were together. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them, and they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize that it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered. He said, throw your net on the right side of the boat and you'll find some. When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciples whom Jesus loved said to Peter, is it the Lord? As soon as Simon Peter heard him say, it is the Lord, he wrapped the outer garment around him, for he had taken it off, and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals there with fish on it and some bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish you have just caught. So Simon Peter climbed back into the boat and dragged the net ashore. It was full of large fish, 153, but even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. None of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. Let's pray. Lord, may we see you in a special way today, in your kind provision, as we might hunger after you in our own special way, each in our own special way, but also as a congregation. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. Are you still hungry after last week when we had communion, when we had the Lord's Supper, we broke bread together, and it wasn't much. A little cup of grape juice. But if I was asking about the physical kind of hunger, that probably wouldn't have met your need. But I'm talking about a spiritual hunger that God seeks to fill in our lives, to change our lives with. And as we see here, Jesus broke bread with his disciples and fed them again, as he had been before. And when I ask you to say, are you hungry again, I don't mean that did you go away feeling less than satisfied with what the choir did, what I said, what everybody else did, the prayers. No, it's about hungering for God. You see, this was the third time Jesus appeared to them. The first time, it was behind locked doors. He gave them their mission. He breathed upon them in John 20, the breath of life. Holy Spirit. And he said, don't let these locked doors. In essence, he was saying, don't let these locked doors keep you from going out in that spirit. He empowered them in such a way to go. And the second time was when he appeared with Doubting Thomas and the rest of the disciples, because he hadn't been there, but he was now. So talked about when God became real is when we could touch him. See the nail prints in his side and his hands. Holding on to faith and the Holy Spirit is all we have in this world that wants some physical proof of God being alive. Because God's not dead. And here the third time is something special of Jesus on the shore of Galilee. And it was about the time when they had been through the night and hadn't caught anything. I don't know if you've ever experienced that. When I grew up, my father was a fisherman on the Mississippi and the Arkansas River, and that's how he earned his living, some sort of living anyway. And to bait up at night and then go and run your lines and your nets in the morning and find nothing was very frustrating. It was hard work. I can imagine the frustrations of these guys. But guess what? They were out fishing because they were just waiting on Jesus because he said he was going to meet them. And he hadn't gotten there yet, and they went fishing. Maybe the other disciples, I know some of them were fishermen, but some of them weren't. And they were still out there together. There were seven of them. Not all of them were there. It was hard to get all of them together, but they were there. There were five that were named and two that were not named, and maybe there were other disciples that were not well known to people and to us. Maybe some of them were sick. Maybe some had other things they had to do, and they just weren't there, just like today. Not everyone's here today. But you see, Peter made that mad dash after James had said something, John. And he swam to shore, and the nets, he had to go back and get some fish. Jesus was ready to feed them again. He built a fire. Just as he had done at the Last Supper. Just as he had done at other times and them following him. That's amazing. For Jesus to prepare another meal. They saw his hands breaking bread again. No one had to ask, were they satisfied? But I believe this asks some questions of us and our discipleship and how we hunger for him in our discipleship and following him. And one of the questions I thought about is, do we go away hungry every week from this place? I hope so. You see, one Sunday a year or two, like C&E Christians, that means Christmas and Easter Christians that come to church. That's not enough. A month of Sundays is not enough. Not enough to satisfy us who hunger each week. Each appearance, I believe, in those three were things that Jesus was reaffirming to them and nailing down his understanding for them and giving their understanding in the way of the Lord. And I believe my battery on this microphone went out. So we'll have to go with this microphone fully. But we have to realize that in each day that we have, there's a sense of, I believe, hunger. Each appearance, each revelation of God, each twinkling of God's eye on earth raises another question in us about what's happening. And I want to know. You see, inquiring minds want to know inquiring minds of Christ. I hope each Sunday God stirs up some questions about fulfilling discipleship. It's amazing how God can touch each person, each struggling Christian, each sinner in this world, not just here in this place, but he still does each individually talk to our hearts. And ask us, are you hungry? I've made breakfast. He even talks to the hypocrites, to the sinners. And we need to be hungry each day. Hunger for God. Which leads us to the next question. Do we hunger for God's provision? He told them to cast their nets, and when they got ashore, there was fish on the fire, and Jesus was ready to feed them. He said, go get what you caught, and here's one thing I caught, and we can put that together and make a difference in your hunger today, as each day. It may not be crystal light lemonade to you. It may be more filling. It may be more satisfying. It may have brought to mind something in their lives, that boy that had brought his loaves and fishes, and they took it to Jesus, and he touched it and multiplied it. That's God's provision in our lives. How often has God multiplied the assurances in your life, or multiplied your efforts to bring about glory to him, or provided you when you didn't have enough? Have you ever experienced that? If you haven't, maybe it's because you haven't put what you have at the disposal of God. You've held on it too closely. You see, we need to hunger for God's provision and giving to him in our offering plate, in our time, in our talents, in our attention span. God notices and provides for our needs. See, he knew that they needed some breakfast when they came in. He knows what we need. When I was in the ninth grade, I remember one particular instance, this girl in the class, she sat behind me, said, "Lawrence, what's wrong?" She noticed I was troubled for some reason. And you know what? That was nice to someone recognize my need, to be heard, to be asked the question. Didn't hurt that she was the prettiest girl in the class. To a poor teenage soul. But that's what God does for us. He wants to provide. He asks. He knows what we need. Not maybe what we want, but what we truly need. And he's telling these disciples in his actions to remind them of other times when he's provided. He said, "Do you remember those things? Remember what I said? How it touched your soul? How you left your fishing nets? How you left the tax table? How..." All kinds of things, with memories would come back to them with each of those appearances and nail in the foundations board about what they needed to know when they went out to be disciples of Jesus in the world, where they would find hunger in other different ways. They would have these memories and they would make more memories. Are we hungering to make more memories? Because I know many of you have memories of this place and this congregation helping you to an understanding of God, and you're hoping to make memories for your children, hope make memories for yourself when you get to the point where you need to remember what God has done in your life. God's going to provide those today for tomorrow, and tomorrow for each day we live. He is there for us. We need to hunger for God's provision of daily bread, fellowship and breaking bread, more fish to catch, and more memories and greater hunger to do his will, to make those memories. And I think there's another question that's asked here. Do we hunger for God? Not just his provision, not just the hunger spiritually, but for God himself and his presence. You see, they were waiting and they had to figure out some kind of way to wait. And Peter said, "Let's go fishing." And that's not my best way of going to wait on something. But that was his way. But he wanted to he was hungering from God, for God. Do we hunger to think that God spent his good time to create the world and he takes his time out to give us what we need? The abundant life for us. So do we hunger for God in his presence? Jesus always sought to feed his disciples so they would hunger for more of those teachings. We hunger for him. Do we hunger for him? You know, in my house, you could hear the words, "Are you still hungry? Or are you hungry again?" If you have teenagers, they come back so often, you just don't know. It's amazing that we look at the children's plate and they walk away from the table and they haven't touched their vegetables, and they'll come back and they say, "Well, what's for dessert?" They're hungry, but they didn't hunger for, and I don't like some vegetables myself.
but they hunger for maybe less filling calories. Sometimes we hunger for the wrong things, the calories that are empty, when we should be asking ourselves, are we hungry for God? Do we hunger for Him? What do we do? What are we there for? Do we hunger for what God has for us? We might leave church today pondering the fate of the roast that's in the oven. We may be hungering for that good slice of pecan pie. We may be hungering for a lot of things, but instead of peas and carrots and other things. But we need to remind ourselves that we need to ponder our fate and what the fate of this world is if we don't do what we need to do, and if we're not hungering for the right things of God and hungering for the abundant life that He brings. You know, the question I asked today may be the question you'd hear from your grandmother, somebody that you always loved to go there and eat and eat. And my grandmother says, "Are you hungry? Or are you still hungry?" Yeah. After the second and third helping, sometimes we're still hungry. And I think we can still be hungry for God, no matter what age and how much He's done for us. He will provide consistently, because when our plate's empty, He's going to fill it up again. When our discipleship has given us a hunger for more, He's going to give us more. If we empty that cup, He's going to fill it up. We can take this life and really understand Matthew 5:6. "Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." We can remember, "Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door shall be open." We hunger for God's presence, His provision, an understanding of who He is. Are we still hungry for God's will to be done in our lives, in the life of this church, in the life of this town? The disciples were waiting to go on their mission that God had told them about, that had given them power of the Holy Spirit. When God provides, He fills us with courage and wisdom and expectancy. Our cup is filled and emptied by doing our discipleship and filled up again. He gives us the fellowship of the church to help us through the hard times. But we should not waste the opportunity for gossiping, for self-aggrandizement, for petty arguments, for disputing people. And we need to hunger and understand that hunger is a state of Christian reality, not of this world. We cast our nets out and it may be empty, but when we do it at God's direction, He provides. We should come to worship and fellowship for more of God's provision more often than we do. And we realize that in John, in the 6th chapter, in the 35th verse, He said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." That's a reality when we come to Him to take Him into our lives. But also we hunger for Him always, to know more, to be, as Paul would say, heaped, overflowing, pushed down, packed down. We know His fullness, even in our needs. We're grateful for that and how He can fill us. And if you have not experienced that, if you may have been in that boat and you didn't know what all this was all about that day and went ashore and you see this man with his nail prints, and now you understand why His disciples were waiting and why they were looking forward to it, and how they know that Jesus, after so much in their lives, was going to provide. You haven't had that provision. Maybe you need to come to Jesus and hunger for Him and for eternal life and abundant life here. Let us pray. Lord, I thank You for the opportunity to share the good news, share who You are in our lives, that If we hunger every day for you, we will be filled beyond measure what you have for us in our discipleship. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we turn to our hymn invitation,
413.
Hymn 413. Won't you come, and if you feel God saying you haven't been hungry enough, maybe you need to rededicate yourself to seeking Him in the table of life. Let us stand as we sing.